zmožnosti, da je odgovorni dan povabljen, da te ti alijani tam se poškati, da je on javne novarne, da je podobno te za kaj, da je kaj, da je kaj. Ljub je plana, ne je svoje, и уловлена малума бъд да на мъм да хата на мъм не може да шума. Това ви не е да смахава е да кадо с работа на арена комисионна да се казва на активна. Да, мишкуни не става много не съзваявам в мандушко подра, а да халко адрес на кифро миши. Мишкуни на Йокра и Сопра. كذلك برضو ده كان المنهج بتاع القرآن في الجدل مع المشركين. يقول هاتوا برهانكم إن كنتم صادقين. إنا أو إياكم لعلى هدى أو في ضلال مبين. يعني إيه الموضوع ما بيخشش بيديلك المعلومة كده يرميها في وشك وأنت عارف من السبب لا في جدل وفي إقناع. فانا هتكلم ده شويه من الكلام ده كده بالعربي بس بعد كده كل الكلام هيبقى بالانجلش. لا لا يعني انا مش متعود اتكلم يعني دي بس دي مقدمه الموضوع ان اهميه التوك اللي انا هقوله. ليس من الضروره انك تستوعب كل اللي انا هقوله لكن دي بس هتديك فكره عن اهميه الموضوع. لان طبعا الموضوع ما ينفعش يتاخد في نص ساعة فده بس يعني ايه هتعمل لك شوية يعني صحوة فكرية وتهزك وتديك ابروش انك تقرا اكثر وليس كل ما يقرا يصدق. تمام؟ The term evidence-based medicine first appeared in the medical literature in the information brochure of internal medicine residency program of McMaster University in Canada in year 1990. The starting point was a problem faced by a clinician during examination of the patient. The clinician found it a difficult problem. So to search for a solution for this problem, the doctor went to the library and tried to look for the relevant literature. Then the doctor was confronted with a tremendous number of literature. Many of them are contradictory to each other. So at this point, a need was felt to emphasize the importance of critical appraisal of information in clinical practice. To do this, an internal medicine based medicine working group was formed at McMaster University in Canada with Professor Gordon Boyer as its chairman. The group worked to develop a series of papers, they call it User's Guide, to emphasize clinical practice and clinical decision making based on sound evidence from clinical research. Putting the principles of evidence-based medicine into reality has resulted in happiness of both of the doctor and the patient. Both of them are laughing. What about the nomenclature? It has been suggested to give the name scientific medicine. Nevertheless, this has been opposed by the fact that our previous practice was unscientific so far. Therefore, it has been agreed to give the name of evidence-based medicine. Evidence-based medicine consists of these words. The first word is the word evidence. So what is the meaning of the word evidence in the term of evidence-based medicine? Evidence consists of observations made with a purpose. Evidence-based medicine checks the validity and the relevance of an information. So what is the meaning of the term medicine in the term evidence-based medicine? According to Oxford Dictionary, it is a discipline for prevention and the cure of the disease. So it is not correct to understand the term evidence-based medicine as evidence-based internal medicine, for example, or evidence-based surgery or evidence-based medicine, but it is correct to understand the term evidence-based medicine as medicine here means doctor's profession, not the profession of law or profession of business. Knowing evidence-based medicine is like knowing 1, 2, 3, 4. Evidence-based medicine has one goal, two fundamental principles, three components, and four steps. Evidence-based medicine has one goal to improve the quality of the clinical care. Two principles, number one, hierarchy of evidence, number two, insufficiency of evidence. Three components, we call it triple E's, evidence, expertise, and expectation. And four components, four steps, we call it four A's, ask, acquire, appraise, apply. Evidence-based medicine has one goal, to improve the health of people through decisions that maximize their health-related quality of life and lifespan. Evidence-based medicine has two principles. Number one, hierarchy of evidence, and number two, insufficiency of evidence. So the first principle of evidence-based medicine is hierarchy of evidence. What is the meaning of the word hierarchy? According to Oxford Dictionary, it is a system with grades of authority or status from the lowest to the highest. So I can say there is a hierarchy in the classification of all living creation. Evidence available in any clinical decision-making can be arranged in order of strength based on its likelihood of freedom from error. So, for example, if I'm going to assess treatment decisions, the strongest evidence could be obtained from meta-analysis of large randomized controlled trial, followed by large multi-center randomized controlled trial, followed by meta-analysis of randomized controlled trial, followed by single-center randomized controlled trial, followed by observational studies, and lastly, the clinical experience or basic research, which has the greatest evidence. The second principle of the practice of evidence-based medicine is insufficiency of evidence alone. The second fundamental principle of evidence-based medicine is that evidence alone is never sufficient for clinical decision-making. It has to be integrated with other two arms, which are clinical expertise and patient's expectations. This principle gives rise to the considerations of the components of evidence-based medicine, which will follow. And these are the three components of evidence-based medicine. We call it evidence, expertise, and expectation. So the term evidence-based medicine is a misnomer. Beside evidence, there are two other E's which are required for decision-making, which are expertise of the decision-makers and expectations of patients. So the second component of evidence-based medicine is expertise, and this example will explain the importance of the expertise. A 28-year-old man is admitted to the intensive care unit with ascending paralysis and respiratory distress. The resident makes a diagnosis of Guillain-Barré syndrome and starts to discuss evidence-based approaches to treatment. The consultant comes and takes a history and suspects dumb rabies. It becomes clear that the patient had a good bite 3 months ago, received only partial immunization. Further investigations confirmed the suspicion of dumb rabies, and the patient was shifted to the infectious disease hospital for further treatment. So the whole discussion on Guillain-Barré syndrome was irrelevant. This example illustrates the role of expertise in practicing evidence-based medicine. If the diagnosis is wrong, all the evidence-based medicine discussion is superfluous. Then the third component of evidence-based medicine is expectations. And this example will explain the importance of the expectation. The diagnosis of motor neuron disease requires a certain level of expertise and experience. Once the diagnosis is made, one looks for evidence in favor of certain treatment like riluzole. There is definitive evidence from randomized controlled trials and meta-analysis indicating that riluzole for 3 months if taken regularly. However, the cost of riluzole treatment is prohibitive. In view of the high cost and risk of hepatic toxicity, many neurologists and their patients do not use this. Patients don't consider it worth it. However, some patients who can easily afford to take riluzole for treatment of this condition are prescribed this drug. Then there are the evidence-based medicine has 4 steps: ask, acquire, appraise, and apply. The first step is ask. Ask for the required information by formulating your clinical question. The second is acquire, which is find the current best evidence. The third is appraise, which is critical analysis of information. And the fourth is apply, which is application of the results to the location. The first step in the practice of evidence-based medicine is ask. Asking a question in a particular format is an important first step. It helps to find the most relevant information and it specifies the outcomes you are looking for. It also helps in assessing the relevance of the information to your patient's problem. And there are 2 types of questions. The first is the background question. These are related to the general information regarding a subject, for example, anatomy, physiology, biochemistry, pathology, pharmacology, etc. And the second type of question is a foreground question, which are related to a specific problem in a specific patient. For example, if I take the subject of the spontaneous passage of urinary stone as an example, a background question is, what are the factors affecting the incidence of a spontaneous passage of urinary stone? But the foreground question is, what is the possibility of a spontaneous passage of this urinary stone in this particular patient? Then the second step in the practice of evidence-based medicine is required, which is finding the best evidence. Acquiring or finding the current best evidence, this will be discussed in the details later on. Then the third step in the practice of evidence-based medicine is appraise. Appraise means critical appraisal or critical analysis of an information, and there are 4 methods to appraise an information. The first is to test for the relevance, the second is to test for the validity, the third is to test for the consistency, and the fourth is to test for the importance. The first method to appraise or critically analyze an information is to test for the relevance. Relevance means the extent to which the research paper matches your information needed. You have to compare your required information with the research paper to determine the degree of relevance between the information needed and the research paper. Then the second method to critically analyze or appraise an information is to test for the validity. Validity means the extent to which the results are free from bias, and the bias is a systematic deviation from the truth. There are 3 types of bias according to the stage of the study. Before the study, selection bias. During the study, measurement bias. And after the study, analysis bias. An example of selection bias is comparing 2 groups, one of which contains significantly more children or more females, An example of measurement bias is absence of control, absence of randomization, absence of assessment by blinded observer, and incompleteness of follow-up. An example of analysis bias is use of improper statistics. Then the third method to test or critically appraise an information is to test for the consistency. Consistency refers to the extent to which the research results are similar across different analyses in the study and are in agreement with evidence outside the study. And the final step to critically analyze or appraise an information is to test for the importance. You have to ask were the results statistically significant and clinically important. What information can you take from the study to your practice population? Then, the final step in the evidence-based medicine is applied. Having found the information in the paper is relevant, valid, consistent, and important, the question is whether the test or treatment will be useful for your patient or practice. Doctor should ask, is this treatment or test is worth, like, is worth the risk and the cost of the new intervention? The doctor should discuss with the patient, what do you think about the benefits and risks associated with the new test or treatment? These considerations will help to apply or not to apply the results of the paper and take a decision. A practice which is based on these considerations is called evidence-based clinical practice. And this is Oxford system for evidence level. Level 1A is meta analysis of high-quality randomized controlled trials. Level 1B is high-quality randomized controlled trial, which is defined as follow-up is complete in more than 80% of cases. Level 2A contains less quality randomized controlled trial, which is defined as follow-up is less than 80% for absence of blinding or improper randomization. Level 2B, meta-analysis of level 2 randomized controlled trial for prospective comparative cohort studies. Level 3 includes case control study or meta-analysis of level 3 study. Level 4 includes case series or retrospective non-controlled study. And level 5 is expert opinion. And this is how to apply the Oxford system for evidence-based medicine. Information, grade A information, is based on level 1 evidence, and this is translated as highly recommended. Grade B information is consistent with level 2 or 3 evidence, and this is translated as recommended. Grade C information is based on level 4 studies, and it is translated as recommended with reservation. Grade D information is evidence inconsistent or inconclusive, and it is translated as not recommended. And these are some of the benefits of application of the practice of evidence-based medicine on our body. Before the era of evidence-based medicine, we thought that clinical and medical education is sufficient to practice medicine lifelong. But after application of the evidence-based medicine practice, we have to know that clinical and medical education is necessary but not sufficient. We also need lifelong self-directed learning and reflective practice. Before the era of evidence-based medicine, we thought that clinical and medical experience is sufficient to guide practice. But after application of the term evidence-based medicine, we have to know that clinical and medical experience are necessary but not sufficient, but also we need to be aware of the research results. Before evidence-based medicine, we thought that reading textbooks are sufficient, but after application of evidence-based medicine, we have to know that reading textbooks are useful but not sufficient. We also need to refer to systematic review articles and original articles. Before evidence-based medicine, we thought that Medline is the resource of first resort. But after evidence-based medicine, we have to know that Medline is the resource of last resort. Before evidence-based medicine, we thought that evidence for basic and animal research are adequate to guide medical practice, but after application of the practice of evidence-based medicine, we have to know that evidence from basic and animal research are necessary but not sufficient. We also need clinical evidence. Before evidence-based medicine, we thought that all what is published in the top journals is largely true, unless contradicted by another publication. But after evidence-based medicine, we have to know that most of what is published even in the top journals is not true or clinically not relevant. Before evidence-based medicine, we thought that reading conclusions of people are sufficient. But after evidence-based medicine, we have to know that reading conclusions of papers are necessary but not sufficient. We also need to read methods and results. Before evidence-based medicine, we thought that critical appraisal ability comes automatically and informally with medical education. But after evidence-based medicine, we have to know that critical appraisal ability needs to be learned actively and formally. Before evidence-based medicine, we thought that statistical significance is sufficient, but after evidence-based medicine, we have to know that statistical significance is necessary but not sufficient. We also need to assess for clinical significance. And these are some of the limitations of the application of the practice of evidence-based medicine. The first is the limited applicability of evidence to an individual patient. The evidence that is most applicable to a patient is the one coming from a study on him alone. Most healthcare professionals do not have the time, facility, or inclination to conduct such studies. Therefore, the evidence that is available comes from averaging over a number of patients. Is this average effect applicable to your patient? You don't know your company. Nevertheless, to have some idea of what happens on average is usually better than having no idea at all. The average effect is what happened to most of your patients. In the absence of a better alternative, this is probably the best knowledge to work with. The second limitation is the lack of consistent evidence and coherent evidence. For many questions, evidence is available but inconsistent and incoherent. Recent controversy on the effectiveness of mammography for breast cancer exemplifies the incoherence that afflicts some of the available evidence. The third limitation is the potential to limit creativity and innovation. Evidence-based medicine puts the standards of proof at such a high level that a new idea may be crushed even before it's proven. The third limitation is need for time from clinicians. Clinicians are busy everywhere, more so in developing countries. The time required to learn even the language of evidence-based medicine is not available. This possesses a major limitation for the clinician, even to read and understand the pre-approved evidence-based medicine literature. The fifth limitation is the limited availability of evidence-based medicine resources. Many of the evidence-based medicine resources are not available, particularly in developing countries. Many clinicians may not have computers or internet access. Under these circumstances, the clinicians cannot access the literature and thus cannot practice evidence-based medicine. Another limitation is need to learn new concepts, new methodological and statistical methods. Many concepts in evidence-based medicine are difficult to learn. One or two workshops are not enough to clarify these concepts. This puts many clinicians off. They develop a kind of aversion towards evidence-based medicine. So I can conclude that evidence-based medicine has one goal, to improve the quality of clinical care. Two, principles, number one, minority of evidence. Number two, insufficiency of evidence. Three components, objectives, evidence, expertise, expectations. And four steps for it, ask, acquire, appraise, upline. Thank you very much.
من المرأة
زي مثلا انما العمل بالنيابة عام بالآخر بالنسبة إنما في الحديث الصحيح اللي هو كل المبني كل عام كلهم موجودين وكلهم قبل بعض وكلهم مشهود لهم بالكفاءة وكلام كده بنفس الطريقة دي بقى الأحاديث الضعيفة بيؤخذ بيها في الحاجات اللي هي حاجات كويسة حلو يعني ماشية مع الفطرة وماشية مع الأخلاق العامة وماشية مع كذا يؤخذ به لأنه يعني بيضعوا مثلا الأخلاق الكريمة بيضعوا كده لكن لو حاجة فاندمنتال حاجة هيترتب عليها قرارات حدود أو قرارات الكلام ده ما ينفعش إلا الأحاديث الصحيحة أو المسجد القرآن فهو ده
في سؤال
قبل الدكتور حسين في سؤال أنا مش كل يعني أنت بتستخدمها برضه بالعقل يعني مش
في سؤال أنا
هو على العموم احنا من الحاجات اللي انا عايز اعملها في المركز هنا انا هجيب المستشار اتفقت مع مستشار وهيدينا محاضرات ازاي الطبيب يتعامل مع الايثيكال بروبلمز لان احنا بنتعامل معاها بطيبه شديده جدا لان ما زال المجتمع المصري طيب لكن في امريكا يعني في المحامين كل راس مالهم هو شغال على اخطاء الدكاتره وبيسد الاخطاء ازاي بيعرف يسد الاخطاء ازاي لذلك انت في امريكا او في اوروبا او بتاع بتلاقي في بريكوشنز بتلاقي كتاب قد كده قبل ما العيان يبدا على الكونسنت يقعد يقرا كل ده وطبعا ما حدش بيقرا ولا حاجه بس ايه هو بيمضي بس لو مضى يبقى هو
اكسبت
هو اكسبت كل اللي هو فبيجيب لك جميع انواع المضاعفات اللي ممكن تحصل في الايه في العيان فاحنا ينقصنا دي انا لذلك انا هعمل الكورس للراجل ده يجي يدينا محاضرات ازاي الدكتور يتعامل ميديكال ليجال مع العيانين وازاي يكتب لما يجيبك ورقه من النيابه يقول لك اكتب لي تقرير عن مفرد اليك ما اعرفش ايه ايه في الحادثه رقم كذا ما اعرفش ايه ده علم على فكره احنا بنستغفر بيه لكن دي حاجه مهمه ان انت ممكن تروح كاتب كلمه في الاخر لو محامي شاطر او كده يقدر ان هو ايه يوقعك وياخد منك معاويض والكلام ده فده يعني ممكن نفكر يعني انا كمدير المركز هعمل دي ان شاء الله وادعو الناس على الاقل الناس اللي في المركز يعرفوا واحنا وانا اول واحد فيه انا برضه من الناس الكبار برضه ازاي ازاي يعني
لكن لو زي شفت اوان ايه كنت خليتها قارينا بياخد ياخد ده اليد
هو بتاع نيابه ما بيبقاش مقتنع مع ما
بيفهمش. عيالك
لا لا هو بتاع الطب الشرعي ده تلاقيه
جي بي اس او جي بي اس
فاهم حاجه
بالعكس جي بي اس